we think about the brewing process, we have four main ingredients: water, malt, hops, and yeast. If we think about our malt, it comes from barley, and it gives us our main constituents that we're going to use in the brewing process. It has carbohydrates, proteins, and some lipids. Let's focus on the carbohydrates. If we think about carbohydrate, this is going to be our main source for the sugar that's going to be converted into alcohol, ethanol. What is a carbohydrate? Well, a carbohydrate, from its name, is a carbon hydrated. So it's going to be a carbon with water added. So therefore, if we think about the structure, we have a very simple formula: CnH2nOn. So most of our sugars are going to be C6H12O6. Now let's look at the structure of our simple carbohydrates. If we look at our carbohydrate, such as glucose, which is going to be our main carbohydrate, it's usually shown in a few different forms. The first structure we see here is actually in a three-dimensional form that organic chemists are very comfortable with because it gives accurately what the structure will look like energetically in solution. But notice that it is a straight chain. The other structure that we're going to use quite often is the fissure projection. A fissure projection doesn't give us the correct information as far as how the molecule will look in three dimensions, but it gives us a very easy way to draw a structure and tell the difference between different sugars. Now, both of these are what we call acyclic. They both have an aldehyde group, and we can see that they have five hydroxide groups. Every carbon in the structure has at least one oxygen bond. Now, this is the acyclic form. We can also have the cyclic form. If we look at the cyclic form, we have the possibility of the rings coming around. So instead of being a straight chain, we now are forming these rings. Notice when we do this that we have one position that has two possibilities. So how this occurs is that one of those alcohols comes around and attacks our carbonyl position. When it attacks that carbonyl position, that hydroxide that's formed can either go up or can go down. So we can either end up with an alpha or a beta. This is going to be important as we look at the functionality of larger carbohydrates. So here we have simple glucose. The other thing to realize about glucose is that all of the hydroxide groups are in the most stable formation. And in fact, if we look at beta-D-glucose, you'll see that all of our hydroxide groups are in the equatorial plane, which is the most stable conformation. Now, these were monosaccharides. When we go to disaccharides, this is when we have two sugars together. The one that we're most concerned with is maltose. If we look at maltose, we have two glucose molecules. It differs from sucrose, another disaccharide you're probably familiar with, because sucrose has a glucose and a fructose molecule. In maltose, we have two glucose molecules. The connection between these we refer to as a 1,4 alpha linkage. This 1,4 alpha linkage is the type of linkage we're going to see in amylose and amylopectin. It is the type of linkage that can be easily divided or broken when we look at different sugars. As we can see here, here's amylose. If we think about amylose, the sugar, it is a long chain carbohydrate. So instead of a mono or disaccharide here, we have lots of glucose molecules connected, and in amylose by 1,4 alpha linkages. These 1,4 alpha linkages can be broken by amylase, the enzyme, into smaller carbohydrates. In malt, what we're looking for is maltose. So the amylose, the carbohydrate, is being converted with amylase, the enzyme, into maltose. When we think about these structures, we also have amylopectin. Amylose, as you can see here, is just a straight chain with all 1,4 alpha linkages. When we look at amylopectin, we still have alpha-type linkages, but we also have 1,6 connections as well as 1,4. If we look at this structure here, you'll see that we have our normal 1,4 alpha linkages, but then up here we have a 1,6 alpha linkage. That's what makes amylopectin a little bit different, and why we need not only alpha amylase, the enzyme, but also beta amylase enzyme to fully break down our carbohydrates. Now, we talked mostly about amylose and amylopectin with alpha linkages. That's because these are the ones that are going to be broken down into fermentable sugars. The other structures we have is cellulose. The malt has cellulose because we have cell walls and we have the plant structure. These are actually useful in the filtering process and to settle out the mash at the end of the mashing process. Notice that in cellulose, we don't have alpha linkages like we would in starch or amylose, but we have a beta linkage. So we can see carbohydrates is where we're going to get our sugar for the yeast to convert it into alcohol. We start with long chain carbohydrates, and then through enzymes, we break that down into smaller maltose and glucose molecules. We start that in the malting process by activating those enzymes. Then we're going to finish that process during the mashing process, where we allow that enzyme and water to work on those long carbohydrates to convert them into small disaccharides, maltose, and monosaccharides, glucose.